Man who cannot repent feels all that he has done in the past was right. I don't know whether in his heart of hearts he actually believes that he was right the whole way through, but he won't accept it. He won't say so, and continues to even refuse that there has been any change for the better.
In the Second World War, Ian Smith fought for king and country. Throughout his illegal break with Britain, called UDI, he considered himself a loyal subject. It was everyone else who was out of step.
There's not a sign of arrogance in him. That's what people like, including me. But subconsciously, he is extremely arrogant. He is a supreme egoist.
It was a very conceited thing to do, to declare UDI like that, and very vainglorious. And I think that he was carried away. That he thought, you know, tactically that's the thing to do at the moment. And he couldn't see what was going to happen in the future when he'd done it.
In spite of the suffering Smith inflicted on Rhodesia, his opponents show little bitterness towards him.
His word seems to me to be his bond. He likes to do the right thing. But to him, the right thing is what is good for the white man.
If you are a fair-minded person, you cannot say, Smith, go home. Where? Where is home?
Come on in, you guys. Home is still Zimbabwe, the former colony that tried to lock out the modern world.
We went on through 15 glorious years of building Rhodesia into a nation that was proud of itself. Mugabe said, we can't get over how fortunate we are inheriting this jewel of Africa. It had been a stimulating period for Rhodesia.
But you blew it.
Unfortunately, at the end, we were betrayed. We never blew it. We were betrayed even by our own friends, and I think the history records this clearly.
Led by Cecil Rhodes, white settlers had carved out Rhodesia by force at the end of the 19th century. They believed they could hold on to what they'd won. But they were living in a time war. The 4 million blacks outnumbered the whites 16 to 1. Virtually none of them had the vote. They were the underclass, farm workers and servants. Britain wanted them trained up to run the country, but for the Rhodesians, this showed how little the British understood Africa.
Sometimes they have to be taught the most rudimentary mechanical movements. But they progress rapidly to more complicated industrial tasks.
When the white man came to this country, they didn't know anything else but grass huts and grass fires. The majority of them couldn't make a wheel.
I'm not prepared to sacrifice everything I've worked for just because Britain wants us to have a black majority rule before time. But the black majority rule will come, and so it should. But they must be ready for it, I feel.
The point is, the average African doesn't know what a vote is. He can't eat it, he can't sleep with it, and he can't spend it, so he's not interested.
They must evolve naturally. We cannot, by law, turn round and say, today you are educated, you are fitted to run this country, because they are not.
White Rhodesians thought that they could defy the winds of change that were blowing through Africa. Across the Zambezi to the north, the British were busy dismembering their empire, giving power to black governments. The whites here, who'd been left without interference for 40 years to run their own affairs, thought that they were just as deserving of full independence as neighboring countries like Malawi or Zambia.
Those were countries that the British taxpayer had pumped millions and millions of pounds in. We were a country that had not one pound aid or help at all. Since 1923, we were self-financing. We governed ourselves. We paid for the education of all the indigenous people, health care, everything. We were more entitled to independence than the other two countries.
It was at a conference in the colonial setting of the Victoria Falls Hotel in 1963 that the dispute came to a head. The Rhodesians claimed that the British agreed to their having independence on their own terms, which would effectively have ruled out black majority rule indefinitely. The British say the Rhodesians simply got the wrong end of the stick. The confusion arose because Malawi and Zambia wanted to break away from a 10-year-old federation with Rhodesia, and all three colonies had to agree to it. Rab Butler, the Conservative minister sent out to broker the deal, needed Rhodesia's support. Ian Smith maintains that to get it, Butler privately offered them full independence too.
Rab Butler used very flowery language, typical of diplomacy and Foreign Office talk. And when I said, "Can we now have this in writing?" he quickly replied, "Oh no, we never do these things that way. There is trust between us, members of the British Commonwealth. We have never put this kind of thing in writing."
The Rhodesian politicians thought they had this assurance from Rab, but Rab has categorically denied it.
Well, it was a typical piece of treachery by the British government. Deceit, diplomacy. There's no doubt, it's obvious, it's absolutely clear. And I was suspicious at the time, because I asked for it in writing. I was the only one.
Rab Butler did put something in writing that evening. It was a secret telegram that he sent to 10 Downing Street. In it, he acknowledges that the Rhodesians are impatient for an answer about independence, but says that he had left the situation completely open. It's the exact opposite of what Ian Smith claims he put in his diary that night. When Smith became Prime Minister the following year, he was determined to get independence for Rhodesia. If Britain wouldn't agree, too bad. In Whitehall, they tried to get the measure of a difficult customer. A character sketch reported, "He's simple-minded, politically naive, with a boy's own paper ring to his patriotic utterances. But his pedestrian and humorless manner could be misleading, and he should not be underrated." In January 1965, Sir Winston Churchill died.
One carriage will close the rank.
World leaders gathered in London to pay tribute.
Close rank.
It gave the new Labour Prime Minister, Harold Wilson, his first chance to test the Whitehall portrait of Smith against the man himself.
Ian Smith came to that funeral, having fought with the RAF during the war. Churchill was one of his heroes, and he wanted to be at his funeral. The government, Harold Wilson, took advantage of that to try to encourage him to come and to make arrangements for serious talks with him.
In St. Paul's Cathedral, Ian Smith found himself cheek by jowl with his opponents. A few rows behind him was the former Conservative Minister Rab Butler, whom he'd accused of treachery. Across the aisle, the Prime Minister, Harold Wilson, determined to frustrate his rebellious plans. The funeral was a solemn moment. What followed came close to farce.
Ian Smith was invited at Harold Wilson's personal insistence by the Queen to the luncheon buffet that took place after the funeral service, and I'm told that when he got a proper motorcycle escort for this, and as they swear professionally into the courtyard of Buckingham Palace, they look back and they no longer had the Prime Minister of Southern Rhodesia in tow. He'd gone straight up Constitution Hill, and it was an hour before his absence was noticed.
Why Smith failed to appear has remained a mystery ever since, though Smith himself detects a snub by Wilson.
He tried to keep me out of the way, so much so that I did not receive my invitation to go to Buckingham Palace for the lunch afterwards.
Smith had his invitation in his pocket. His High Commission told us that he had his invitation in the pocket, and he chose not to go.
Why?
Not the slightest idea. It was the sort of wriggly man he was. And is it all tied up with his desire, I suppose, to be there and not to be there, not to be seen to be hobnobbing with anybody else. I don't know.
The chap who ran government hospitality, who was an old friend of mine, a retired brigadier, and rather of a choleric disposition, he was dispatched to bring Ian Smith back. He found him in the hotel where he was, having a separate lunch there, because I think he was frightened to go and mix with the rest. And he was brought back under escort.
I was having my lunch when the Queen's equerry arrived. It said the Queen had sent him to fetch me and bring me to Buckingham Palace. Well, of course I went.
I think the brigadier sort of drew himself up and said, Sir, I have it in the Queen's command.
She couldn't have been kinder and more gracious when I arrived, went out of her way to come and greet me.
The confusion continued after the palace lunch was over. Smith was invited to talks at 10 Downing Street. He knew his party at home would sniff out any hint of compromise, so it suited him to keep the meeting secret. When it became known, he blamed the subterfuge on Wilson.
We went to 10 Downing Street, but specifically at Wilson's request, we didn't come in the front way because there were pressing people like that. There was a back entrance, and the driver knew where that was and took us there, so we came in the back entrance.
He certainly insisted on coming in and out of number 10 by the back door, by the garden gate. I suppose he didn't want it known that he had been to see Mr. Wilson.
He later had talks with both the Canadian Prime Minister, Lester Pearson, and with Bob Menzies, the Australian Prime Minister, and to both of these they said, well, you've talked with Harold Wilson. He said, no, I have not seen him at all. The moment when one realized that he believes his own lies at the point at which he tells them. And that does make discussions a bit difficult.
Zimbabwe must be free. Zimbabwe must be free.
In Rhodesia, under colonial rule, the vote was only given to those who qualified by education or wealth. That excluded most black people. The nationalist leader, Joshua Nkomo, was alarmed that there might be a stitch-up, a deal made over the heads of the blacks to keep the whites in power for years to come.
The movement that is pushing the people is bigger than the battalion. It cannot be short.
But the nationalists were divided, and violent feuding broke out between them. It gave Smith the excuse he needed to suppress them. The black political parties were banned and their leaders detained. It led to rioting in the townships, but meant that Smith had deprived blacks in Rhodesia of political direction.
We took them out of circulation. People began to forget about them. So it served its purpose with us.
Nkomo and dozens of other nationalists were confined to remote camps in the bush. Gona Kadzingwa, near the eastern frontier with Mozambique, was one center for the detainees. They were left there to molder for a decade.
Gona Kadzingwa was really a terrible place. Right in the thick of a wilderness. It had these insects which would come to your face, and this time you are irritated by them and so on and so forth. It was a place that I don't think was suitable for human habitation.
They lived like kings down there. They had all the food they wanted, all the liquor they wanted. They were really on the pig's back.
The last 80 or 90 miles into this camp are over some very, very rough bush track indeed. So although the restricted people are now allowed to have visitors, it's unlikely that they'll have many. And in fact, we are amongst the first to come here. Mr. Nkomo, what do you feel Britain can do in the circumstances?
Well, Britain should call a constitutional conference to be attended by representatives of all representative political parties, that is, African and European.
Back in London, Wilson and his government were floundering. His majority in Parliament was precarious, and his cabinet uncertain how to head off a rebellion by white Rhodesians who had friends and relations in Britain. Should they send troops, arrest Smith, occupy the country?
Harold equivocated terribly. He was frightened of what he used to call the kith and kin argument, which he said the opposition would use at the slightest opportunity.
The cabinet was being advised by defense chiefs that any military action would be hazardous. But there were also murmurings from serving officers uneasy at the prospect of taking on their Rhodesian counterparts.
I remember Jim Castles did warn me, he was the chief of the general staff at that time, the head of the army, that there would be real difficulty.
In what terms did he put that?
Well, he just put it that way. I'm not a fool. I knew what he meant.
Yes, you have to be a little bit racial. Could you really send British troops into action against people they had fought alongside in World War II?
I said, tell them to keep their traps shut. And I'm not going to have this sort of chatter. Public chatter would be mutiny, or the threat of mutiny. This is a political matter of which politicians take decisions and not the military. I didn't add, of course, that a wise politician takes notice of the views of the military on these issues.
After a week of talks, Smith rejected the deal.
Have you made any concessions at all, Mr. Smith?
No, we Rhodesians don't concede.
Clear the way, please.
No rest, please, please.
This way, please, Mr. Smith. Thank you.
The talks had failed, and both Smith and Wilson took their case to the public.
I want to report to you tonight about the very grave situation in Rhodesia.
We are told that we cannot be master in our own house.
A Rhodesia which took its independence by unilateral action, without the authority of Parliament, will be acting illegally in a state of rebellion, and we would have to act accordingly.
The British government has allowed our case to deteriorate into this fantastic position. Almost comical, if it were not so tragic.
I can do business with Ian Smith, and I recognize his great sincerity, even though I disagree with him, even though I feel we're living in different worlds, almost different centuries.
Perhaps there was something in that, because we were part of old Britain, the old empire, as opposed to the Commonwealth, where there was trust and people honored their agreements.
I know I speak for everyone in these islands, all parties, all our people, when I say to Mr. Smith tonight, Prime Minister, think again.
Did you think again?
No, because we'd given the matter so much thought. We'd made up our minds, and we'd gone so far there was no going back.
2 weeks later, Wilson followed Smith to the Rhodesian capital, Salisbury. It was a last-minute attempt to stave off independence and the sort of dramatic gesture he always enjoyed.
Hours before Mr. Wilson's aircraft was due at Salisbury, thousands of Africans had swarmed to the airport. They were convinced that the British government is behind them in their demands. The watchword of the Africans is one man, one vote.
I felt this was the last throw in the game. I'd for long believed that they intended to take their independence, and that it was a sort of Greek tragedy playing itself out.
Rhodesian Premier Ian Smith was not there to welcome Mr. Wilson. The Prime Minister told the press, "It would have been wrong for me not to come to try to solve the problem."
But Wilson had no strategy for preventing UDI, the unilateral declaration of independence, and only one apparent tactic. talk, and more talk. Over 5 days, Wilson met more than 100 community leaders, black and white. He spoke to everyone who mattered and pleased no one. Wilson insisted on meeting the nationalist leaders Smith had detained. With their supporters demonstrating outside Government House, they were brought from their detention camps to see him. Both Sotoli and Nkomo had to wait their turn to fit into Wilson's crowded schedule.
They arrived at Government House late in the afternoon, having been travelling in a truck all day from their detention camp, which is in the hot southern part of the country.
And this truck was left in the sun with us inside for almost an hour. You can imagine how we felt. We had to knock the doors to get out of that inferno.
And when they got out, Wilson said, have you had any food? And they said, not since 7 this morning. And he was absolutely furious. And he turned on the Rhodesian and said, another thing's going to happen till they've been fed, and they've been fed with the same food that was served to me at lunch.
We were all very astonished, because normally Mr. Wilson was a very calm person. But this really stuck in his gullet, that what he saw as being a sort of racial attitude to African leaders who had come to see him, the British Prime Minister.
Apart from a square meal, Wilson offered the black leaders little comfort. He claimed to be on their side, but wasn't telling them what they wanted to hear.
Some people were very jubilant. I wasn't, because he was a British Prime Minister, and the British were responsible for the colonization of Zimbabwe. So I wasn't that happy. I knew they would play kith and kin politics, and I told Wilson that.
What did you say to him?
I said, you are not here to do us real justice. You are merely pretending.
Hovering in the background was a supporter of Sotoli's who would come to play the key role in Rhodesia's history, Robert Mugabe.
We didn't get from Wilson the assurances we wanted. We asked him, would the British government use troops? He said no. Then we knew that the UDI would take place. And we said, why won't you use troops? He said, oh, because the British public won't stand for it. And I remember a question being asked by Edson Drobo. Are we negotiating with the British public? Exactly like that.
There was a gulf between what the nationalists and their supporters were fighting for and what Wilson was offering. He thought any transition to black rule should be gradual. The black leaders wanted it straight away, just as the British High Commissioner had predicted.
They both said exactly the same thing, that it's the duty of the British government to install us as the government of Rhodesia, without delay. No question of any gradualness, no question of any political apprenticeship. That was the British government's duty, full stop.
I don't think Rhodesia at this moment is in a position, because it's so tragically divided and because of this bitterness, to have majority rule, one man, one vote tomorrow. I do say that where Britain has ruled, we have brought them along to self-government. In areas where a different philosophy, a kind of white settler overlordship, has ruled, there is much less evidence that they are ready for self-government.
He listened to them patiently, tried to persuade them that, you know, there was couldn't do everything overnight, that you had to learn the trade. Oh, no, we've got plenty of white civil servants here. We don't need to learn about government. He didn't make any impression on them at all.
It was a good thing, because after meeting them, he became closer to us than he did to them. He couldn't get over how unreasonable they were. So we didn't lose out on that.
Wilson had failed to placate the blacks and had no more success with the whites. He handed Smith a letter from the Queen, hoping to appeal to their loyalty. Smith turned it to his own advantage.
There's a message from that gracious lady our Queen. I would like to read it to you, because although it is addressed to me, it is a message to the people of Rhodesia. And she says, "Dear Mr. Smith, I have followed the recent discussions between the British government and your government with the closest concern. I am very glad to know that Mr. Wilson will be paying you a visit. I earnestly hope that your discussions will succeed. I should be glad if you would accept my good wishes and convey them to all my peoples in your country. Yours sincerely, Elizabeth R."
The Rhodesian leadership was deaf to lectures from Britain about allegiance.
I upset Harold Wilson, I'm afraid, because he turned round to Ian Smith and he said, "What about your loyalty to the Queen, to the Crown?" And I'm a little bit hot-tempered occasionally, and I burst out, which I should not have done perhaps, and I said, "Loyalty? You're talking about loyalty? We got 13 cabinet ministers on this side of the table, and 12 of them were in the forces supporting Britain during the war. And those of us from South Africa were volunteers. We weren't conscripted." And I said, "What have you got on your side of the table? What did you do during the war?" "Well, did nothing. He was in the supply department in office." So that upset him. And Ian Smith had to apologize for me. And he said, "Please forgive Mr. Mustard. I've just recently appointed him. He's a brand new minister."
Wilson was now under personal attack, and not just from the whites. Both sides were questioning his loyalty and patriotism.
Harold Wilson's present visit to Salisbury is regarded by the 4.5 million people of Zimbabwe as a treacherous one. For never in the British colonial history has a British Prime Minister crawled on his belly to go and parley and discuss with a rebel. We expect nothing else from this visit except another Munich. We are going to be loyal to the Queen, and we've made our position very clear to the British government and to the Queen that we will uphold law and order.
After all, let's remember, Harold Wilson was the leader of the Labour Party. And the Labour Party, I don't know, you can correct me, has never won a war in Britain. Requires the Conservatives. They are the people that will rally the British if they go to war. I strongly believed that if it was a Conservative Party in London at that time running, Ian Smith would never have dared, because they were going to blood him up.
Blooding up had been ruled out. Wilson tried a little buttering up instead.
He said to me, "It would be one of the happiest occasions of his life if he could make an agreement with me." He said, "My dear friend, Ian," we were on Christian name terms, he said, "it's easy for you to come to an agreement with me," he said, "but what you've got to do is to give me an agreement which I can sell to the rest of the world and the OAU. It's not just for you and me."
He was right on that point.
Well, I'm not sure that he was. I said to him, "Why have you got to sell it to the OAU? They're a bunch of communist dictators, aren't they? Surely the British government should be above that." "No," he said, "I could never get away with that."
Any hint of intimacy was dashed when Ian Smith played host to Harold Wilson and his party, an evening no one present would ever forget.
It degenerated, really, into a sort of rugby football club annual dinner. And had hardly the soup been cleared when stories started to be circulated, rather off-color stories and so on. And then as the sort of pièce de résistance, His Grace the Duke of Montrose, known as Lord Graham, he was the great funster of the party, and he was persuaded to dance.
Angus Graham set the tone. He was a great raconteur and a teller of jokes. So Angus took the floor and told them a number of jokes which were quite hilarious. But I could see they weren't enjoying it, because it wasn't the sort of thing they wanted.
The dance considered a sort of very gyratory and mock-erotic, but the central feature was that he put a penny between his buttocks, and the secret was to keep the penny between his buttocks all the time he was gyrating. And no business was conducted at that meeting, whatever.
He had a coin that he played around with, and between his bottom and his fingers and his hands, and nothing filthy, just funny.
Harold Wilson came back really rather furious. He was both disgusted, quasi-amused, but felt that, you know, time had been lost. Here he was, he'd come 6,000 miles to Salisbury in order to try and conduct business with everybody in Salisbury, and here was a total evening wasted.
They were people with very considerable capacity to organize themselves for an effective rebellion, as it turned out. And I think we misjudged that. And to some extent, that kind of episode was one of the sources of what clearly, as the time went on, was a misjudgment.
Perhaps a greater misjudgment was Harold Wilson's decision just before he left Salisbury to fly home to London to spell out his own tactics. He'd already told the black nationalist leaders in private that there was no question of Britain using force to prevent UDI. He now said the same thing in public, effectively throwing away his trump card.
I've met African leaders again and again and again, but I've had to tell them, and it was not easy, and it was a bitter pill for them to swallow, that their demand for Britain to attempt to settle all Rhodesia's constitutional problems with a military invasion, this demand is out. And if there are those in this country who are thinking in terms of a thunderbolt hurtling from the sky and destroying their enemies, a thunderbolt in the shape of the Royal Air Force, let me say that thunderbolt will not be coming.
He never gave me any warning he was going to make this statement publicly. Nor had he ever actually taken that position with me privately, because we discussed this regularly, both one-to-one and in the relevant cabinet committee. So I thought it was a disastrous error. We had to keep the military option constantly in front of Smith, because it was likely to act as a deterrent.
He signaled clearly in the minds of the white that they can declare UDI. They will not find themselves in a situation where they'll fight against the British army. And everyone then rallied, everyone, I say everyone, I mean white, the Rhodesians rallied behind Smith and said, go ahead.
And we knew why the British were saying it was impossible. Because if it were black people at that time who had taken New Deal, the whole force, the mighty force of the British Empire, would have been loaded on them. But they did not want to spill the blood of their kith and kin, because maybe it would have backfired in Britain.
The representative of the Crown and of British authority in the colony was the governor, Sir Humphrey Gibbs. From Government House, he wielded the same powers in Rhodesia as the Queen in Britain. It meant he had to do Smith's bidding, even when he suspected Smith's motives. 4 days after Wilson's departure, Smith asked the governor to declare a state of emergency for security reasons. The loyal Sir Humphrey knew what was up.
And so he tackled Smith about this, and that, saying, isn't this not for the security purposes, but for UDI? And Mr. Smith categorically said no, there was nothing of the sort.
As governor, he was forced to act on the advice of his ministers, and his ministers advised him there was a state of emergency, and he had to sign it, which he did with great reluctance and believing it to be bogus.
This has nothing to do with the UDI.
Will you be sending a message?
If we want a state of emergency for the UDI, we'll have one for the UDI. This is quite straightforward. That a boy.
Ian Smith now had the powers to act as he wanted without consulting Parliament. Thursday, November the 11th, 1965, Armistice Day. The previous night, Smith's cabinet had finally decided to go for UDI. Smith told them to sleep on it and meet again in the morning. In London, Wilson was up all night trying to reach Smith by telephone, but it wasn't until just before dawn in London that he got through. Smith's cabinet was already in session. The entire call was recorded and transcribed. On page after page, Wilson flatters Smith, cajoles him, pleads for time. Smith barely speaks. At one point, Wilson says how close to a settlement they are and seems upset when Smith disagrees.
Apparently, Ian Smith remained very calm, very friendly, but obdurate. I thought the Rhodesian cabinet had already decided things had gone too far and so on. And when Harold reported it, he said to us in cabinet, he said he had the... He was very calm. He said, the calm of a madman.
Ian Smith was away for about half an hour. And when he came back, all I can remember him saying is that, well, that's made up my mind. I don't think we have any alternative now. We must just go ahead.
I asked every single member of my cabinet, one by one, not getting a consensus, every single one, I faced them and said, what do you want? And they all gave the same answer. So we then made preparations to sign the Declaration of Independence.
Oh, Lord,
signed under a picture of the Queen. Was that deliberate?
I think that was always part of the cabinet. We always sat under the monarch, under the Queen. I don't think there was anything unusual about that.
Even when you were committing treason?
Well, we weren't committing treason. We were satisfied. We were doing what was right, and we were just trying to draw the attention of the British government to the fact that they were being deceitful.
For the first time since America in 1776, a British colony was defecting. It seemed appropriate to draft a Declaration of Independence. Smith's colleague Jack Howman started by copying the American version, word for word.
But there's one bit that concerned me. That all men are created equal, and that I found I couldn't accept. I didn't believe it true, so I left it out altogether.
The mood of ministers in Salisbury was sober rather than euphoric. Some surprised themselves by the comfort they sought.
I'm not a very religious person who attends church regularly, unfortunately. But on that particular morning, I had the urge to go into St. Mary's Cathedral next door. And I sat down on the back of the church there for a while, in the quiet and peacefulness there, to try and get my thoughts together, to try and settle my thoughts, to make me feel more content and satisfied that I was doing the right thing. And strange to say, there was another cabinet minister in front of me.
I'm not a churchman as a general rule, but I felt very deeply about this action. And I felt that it might help to invite the Lord's intervention and hope that things worked out properly.
Ian Smith had one final duty, to inform the governor of the momentous step he had taken.
I don't believe the governor really could actually take it in at first.
He simply said to me, well, this is it, is it? So I said, regrettably, yes.
And he then informed Mr. Smith that he and the cabinet were dismissed. And I think they parted on very unfriendly terms.
This is the Rhodesia Broadcasting Corporation. The time is 1:15. Here is the Prime Minister of Rhodesia, the Honourable Ian Douglas Smith.
We opened up the teleprinter line to London, and my deputy and I took it in turns to listen to the broadcast, make notes of what he was saying, dictate the speech over the teleprinter. So it was coming out in London, only at about 15 seconds delay.
We, the government of Rhodesia, do hereby declare that the people of Rhodesia fully support the request of their government for sovereign independence. That, in the belief that procrastination and delay strike at and injure the very life of the nation, the government of Rhodesia consider it essential that Rhodesia should attain without delay sovereign independence, the justice of which is beyond question.
We had no alternative. We debated this week after week after week. We had no alternative.
There was an alternative. That was to carry on as they were, because Rhodesia was virtually an independent country, had its own civil service, its own governor, its own armed forces. So they could have gone on as they were, untroubled for years and years and years.
Now, therefore, we, the government of Rhodesia, in humble submission to Almighty God, who controls the destinies of nations, conscious that the people of Rhodesia have always shown unswerving loyalty and devotion to Her Majesty the Queen, do, by this proclamation, adopt, enact, and give to the people of Rhodesia the constitution annexed hereto. God save the Queen.
He's committing an act of gross treason, and he ends by saying, God save the Queen. It's ludicrous.
Now, if I may, I would like to say a few words to you. In the lives of most nations, there comes a moment when a stand has to be made for principle, whatever the consequences. This moment has come to Rhodesia.
I thought he was a mad person. I thought he was working against the interest of the people he purported to be serving. I thought at that time, when time comes, the white men will go out of Rhodesia through the window because they will have no time to get to the door.
I believe that we are a courageous people, and history has cast us in a heroic role. We have struck a blow for the preservation of justice, civilization, and Christianity. And in the spirit of this belief, we have this day assumed our sovereign independence. God bless you all. The Prime Minister's broadcast will be repeated at the following times today, at 4:05.
We wondered what was happening. Why should our people not react to UDI by way of protests and demonstrations and strikes? There we were in prison, and the people were leaderless, and there was nobody to organize them.
When I made my broadcast to the nation, I was emotionally upset. My wife said she'd never seen me quite so upset. I said, I just want to go to my room and lie down. And she wouldn't let anybody else come and see me that day. So it wasn't a happy day for me.
What had upset you?
The fact that I'd had to face up to this decision and then be the person who would make the broadcast and tell the nation that we had made this dreadful decision, a dreadful decision of declaring our independence and breaking with Britain. That didn't come easily. Oh, no.
How do you feel about UDI?
Well, I feel some action Mr. Smith could have taken is UDI.
I think he should have taken it a year ago.
This UDI is for independence, for happiness and prosperity, progress for all.
As far as I'm concerned, it's very disastrous.
Can you give me a reason why?
You see, mostly I say if the British government applies embargoes or sanctions, it is the African who is going to suffer the most.
In London, supporters of the black nationalists were powerless to help. They wanted Britain to use force, but Wilson was only proposing a trade embargo. Round one had gone to Ian Smith.
We'd failed, and therefore one was sad about failure. But we had adjusted our minds well in advance to the likelihood of failure. And in a sense, you know, we could close that chapter, and there was a relief.
The world has taken a step backwards today by the action of a group of small and frightened men. And it's now our task, without rancor, to take those measures which will bring the Rhodesian people back from this dangerous path into which they've been led.
In Rhodesia, there was no immediate sense of danger. An unruffled Smith carried on as though nothing had happened, in spite of worldwide condemnation, which grew stronger by the day.
They thought there'd be a tremendous song and dance in the United Nations and in the British Parliament and everywhere, but that it would gradually die down, that other things would arise to distract the attention of the world community, and they'd gradually slide into tacit acceptance. They couldn't have been more wrong.
Nobody in the wildest dreams would have thought that it was going to go on till 1980 and there'd be a big war and finish up in disaster.
The man once dismissed as simple-minded and naive had outmaneuvered Harold Wilson. But it was Wilson, not Smith, who better understood what was to come.
Many innocent people, men and women and children of all races, black and white, could lose their lives. It's a nightmare with which I have to live, that this could be enacted on British soil in Africa.
Beyond the celebration.
Ladies and gentlemen, the fight goes on.
A country torn apart.
Yes, we are ready just now. We are ready to take part.
Isolated.
It was clear that he was really sending me a message that Ian Smith is expendable.
Abandoned.
What did South Africa owe Rhodesia?
Even by its closest friend.
To come and say that we betrayed him. No, he betrayed us.
How the tide of rebellion turned. Next Sunday at 8. BBC Two.
Rhodesia's white settlers had broken away from Britain. They'd followed the example of the Americans back in the 18th century.
Hello, Mr. Scott, how are you? Hello.
Rhodesia was now an illegal state. Its Prime Minister, Ian Smith, committed to white rule. The only black leaders he was prepared to entertain were the traditional tribal chiefs.
Oh, here's Chief Chirao. Good morning, Chief.
Good morning, sir.
How are you? You all right?
I'm all right, sir.
You see, they've had good rains in Matabeleland, haven't they?
Yes, sir.
Very good rains, yes.
Very good, yes.
Oh,
the
Matabeles are all smiling when they come.
The most popular host at garden parties in Salisbury used to be the governor, Sir Humphrey Gibbs. He was now a virtual prisoner in Government House. Smith had cut off his telephone, confiscated his car, and stopped his salary. He had become a non-person.
Do you intend to evict the governor by force, if necessary?
The governor?
Yes.
We haven't got a governor in Rhodesia anymore.
Privately, it was a different matter. Smith was keen to keep in touch with the British government as long as it could be done in secret. And Gibbs was his point of contact. The illegal Prime Minister and the governor used to meet in Gibbs's study at Government House. But in order that no one should suspect anything, Smith always arrived under cover of darkness. He came on foot to the bottom of the grounds and was met there by the governor's ADC.
He would come over the fence where I would meet him and lead him down winding paths at dead of night to the governor's study. This was all very secret. It would have done Ian Smith no good nationally if it seen that he was in fact talking to the man whom he had dismissed and in effect put under house arrest.
This kind of double dealing became a way of life during Rhodesia's rebellion. No one could be trusted, as Ian Smith found out at the hands of his closest friends. Early one December morning, a cameraman at Salisbury Airport got a scoop. He spotted an RAF Comet from Britain on the tarmac. Moments later, he watched the governor, Sir Humphrey Gibbs, and Rhodesia's Chief Justice, Sir Hugh Beadle, arrive to board the plane. But it was the final passenger who gave the game away, the Prime Minister, Ian Smith. Their destination was Gibraltar, for secret talks on a warship with the British Prime Minister, Harold Wilson. The RAF crew invited Smith, the wartime fighter pilot, to take the controls.
The chap who was with me suddenly said, I'm just going out for a minute. And I said, that's fine. So I was driving this thing away with the governor and Hugh Beadle in the back with this dreadful rebel Smith driving the aeroplane, complete control. And the fellow had left me, stayed out for more than a minute. He was out for about 20 minutes, and he suddenly came running back and said, are you all right? What's happening? Oh, I said, everything's fine, thanks. You can go back to where you were before. And then when we landed at Ascension Island, for some reason or other, and this is typical of the British government, they decided that they didn't want us on the same aeroplane. Smith the Rebel flying in the same aeroplane as the governor. So they produced another aeroplane, and we flew separately from Ascension to Gibraltar.
The idea was that he should get there, that he, the governor, should get there before Smith, the rebel prime minister, and that he, the governor, should be at the head of the gangplank when Smith came up to see him and receive him at the same time as the admiral who was there and the prime minister. The notion was of reasserting that Humphrey Gibbs was the Queen's governor with that authority, and Smith was what he was.
Did it cross your mind that you might be arrested once you were in the custody of the British Navy?
No, I never believed that. I didn't think that that would be part of the scheme, because I don't think the British Navy would have been part to that.
They woke up next morning to find themselves steaming through the Western Mediterranean aboard the cruiser HMS Tiger. The British plan was to put pressure on Ian Smith by isolating him at sea. They went out of their way to treat him like a rebel.
The Prime Minister had the Admiral's cabin, the Governor had the Captain's cabin, and both those had large day cabins. And that meant a big bedroom, as would be described in a house, and a big sitting room and a bathroom. Ian Smith was to be given a very small sleeping cabin, perhaps 9 foot by 6 foot, with just room for a bunk.
He'd sort of put us into the second class quarters, that kind of thing. It didn't worry me. Well, in the name of heaven, does it worry me? I had a bed and I slept. But he had better quarters, sure.
I think there was a consistent attempt to perhaps to demoralize them a bit. While we were putting the conference table together for the wardroom, I was asked if I could provide two chairs, one for Wilson, one for Gibbs, which would be higher than the others and with arms, so that Smith wouldn't have one.
At first, it looked as though a settlement could be swiftly agreed. The Rhodesians would promise steady progress towards majority rule, but the British wouldn't insist on a deadline for bringing it in. The sticking point was how to end the rebellion. Wilson insisted that before getting legal independence, Rhodesia must submit to British control under the governor's authority. Smith suspected this was a trap. During a pause in the discussions, the Rhodesian Prime Minister was invited to the petty officer's mess.
It was the chief petty officer who held up his glass and said, "Here's to Rhodesia." So, you know, I sort of looked around, but it was serious, and we all drank to Rhodesia. And he then said this to me, and it's still very clear in my mind. He said, "You look surprised. You don't have to be surprised. Yet I want to tell you that the complement of this ship is," whatever it was it 678, some such number as that. He said, "I want to tell you that 676 are behind you. The other two buggers have gone overboard long ago." Those are the very words that he used to me.
What happened next is still disputed more than 30 years later. The British thought they were on the brink of a deal. Naval officers remember the mood of optimism.
I was told on the last afternoon that agreement had been reached and that we were to steam back to Gibraltar. All restrictions were lifted on the Rhodesians. They were shown round the ship. We all had tea together and all was sweetness and light. Everybody was very friendly and very cheerful, including the Rhodesians.
The mood changed abruptly. Smith received a coded telegram from Salisbury, and his attitude seemed to harden. He was now refusing to sign any deal before consulting his cabinet, and that meant flying home.
Oh, Wilson wouldn't have that. You've got powers to sign. I told you that you had to have powers to sign, and you said you'd got them.
Smith says he'd never intended to sign. He was just being helpful by offering to find out what his cabinet thought.
Well, I said, if they all agree, that's for them to decide. But I said, in all honesty, I must tell you that it is unacceptable to me.
HMS Tiger was now approaching Gibraltar. Wilson gave orders that Smith wasn't to leave the ship.
I was asked to see that all boats were sent away from the quarterdeck gangways, and armed marines were posted.
By this time, I said to Ian, "Let's get out of here. Otherwise, we'll find ourselves in the bloody tower."
Smith finally disembarked, leaving a signature behind. But it was not on an agreement, only on a record of the discussions. Once back in Salisbury, his cabinet took all day before telling Wilson his proposals were repugnant. Tiger was dead.
And so, as you will no doubt have guessed, ladies and gentlemen, the fight goes on.
Harold Wilson still thought that he could bring Ian Smith to heel here on the streets of Salisbury. At the very start of UDI, he'd imposed economic sanctions. The theory was that in no time, the shop windows would empty, the petrol pumps would run dry, and in weeks rather than months, the rebellion would come to an end. What he hadn't allowed for was that friendly neighbours would rescue Rhodesia from any trade boycott.
The position was no boycotts, but no boycott breaking either. So South Africa just stood by and carried on its normal business in a normal way.
But the amount of trade hugely increased.
But you can never define normal trade as being stagnant. So in any case, everybody tries to increase normal trade in a normal way.
One product was essential to Rhodesia's survival, oil. Without it, Smith's rebellion would collapse. Britain blockaded the port where it was landed, but South Africa again came to the rescue. Oil poured across the frontier at Beit Bridge, by road and by rail. Much of it passed through the hands of the South African subsidiary of the British company BP. Although part owned by the British government, BP was running rings round sanctions. Wilson's cabinet kept quiet, hoping nobody would notice.
to have gone out of our way to describe to everybody where the sanctions were flawed, we'd simply have encouraged the rebellion in Rhodesia. It would have been a very, very self-inflicted wound.
Rhodesians needed no encouragement. With South Africa's help, they were getting round sanctions. Petrol was now so plentiful that rationing was abolished, and the rebellion looked set to last not weeks, not months, but years.
This time when we told the Bell of Independence to mark the fact that yet another year of our independence has passed, another successful year.
Not everything was going Smith's way. Black Rhodesians in exile had set up guerrilla training camps in neighboring countries. From these bases, they launched raids across the border. The recruits were being trained and armed by Russian and Chinese communists.
They took help from every quarter which was prepared to give them help to fight the enemy. If they were communists supplied with weapons, what was wrong with that? But naturally it did not mean that they were communists themselves.
Attention. Hey, what?
Good morning, freedom fighters.
Good morning, Commissar.
Here are the news which I've collected from our radio.
Chikarema's men had joined forces with guerrillas of the South African ANC, whose aim was to overthrow apartheid. The Rhodesians produced evidence of this link. It provoked the South African Prime Minister, John Forster, to send Smith reinforcements, paramilitary police and helicopters.
Forster said, "We've got the communists coming down through your country across the Zambezi, the terrorists to our part of the world." And he said, "The further north we can hold the line against communist encroachment down the continent of Africa, the better."
The essential help was helicopters and light aircraft. And of course, they were our supply lines. All our ammunition and everything came from them. So we were completely dependent on their help.
I'm the South African police liaison officer. We are very proud of serving in Rhodesia and regard it as a very great honor. And we have no doubt that in our combined effort, we will maintain a law and order in South Africa as well as in Rhodesia.
The two white governments had united against the black threat. The Rhodesians were glad of the extra numbers, but were skeptical of the value of urban South African police in a tough war in the bush.
I must be honest that they were in no way fitted to fighting a guerrilla war or counterinsurgency operations in any way. And I have a lasting memory that whenever I walked into the camp, there was always a smell of bubble gum and Brill cream. The South African police were always called slopies, and I gather that comes from the shape of the forehead being sloped backwards. And whenever they made a mistake, they would strike their forehead. Ooh, what?
Ons sal lewe, ons sal sterwe, ons vir jou, Suid-Afrika.
The divisions on the black side were far more serious. In the early years, the liberation movement ZAPU had been united under Joshua Nkomo. But even before UDI, cracks had begun to show.
We felt Nkomo was too moderate for the situation. We felt the situation needed dynamic action.
Sithole led a breakaway party. ZANU was committed to armed struggle. One of the last to defect was Nkomo's publicity officer, Robert Mugabe.
Would you be ready to take power immediately?
Yes, we are ready, just now. We are ready to take power, and we feel...
I was the last, really, to abandon Nkomo, because I didn't want disunity. I wanted us, if there was any change, to have that change within ZAPU. And I was the last, and even Nkomo said, ah, and Mugabe too, had two Mugabe.
That was one of my happiest days in life, because we have this man here with us. It was Mugabe sitting on my left. Today, the man who has always been very difficult to extricate from Nkomo, today he is with us, away from Nkomo.
The black nationalists' first victory wasn't won on the battlefield. In 1972, they overturned a deal Smith had struck with the new Conservative government in Britain. It would have increased the number of black MPs, but kept the whites in power for many years. First, it had to be accepted by the majority black community. And when they were asked their opinion, the answer was clear. But the No campaign couldn't be run by the nationalist leaders. They were all in detention or exile. They'd been forced to choose a figurehead who was still at liberty.
So they said, what better to do than to utilize the first black bishop in Rhodesia, Muzorewa. Muzorewa declined. He said, no, I'm a churchman, don't involve me in these things and so forth. I'm very thankful, you know, if you are impressed. No. Send out another communication, insisting. Muzorewa declined. Send out a third. And he accepted.
See, I was bishop of the church already, and I don't need any more responsibilities. But for some reason, I want to believe that reason was they had heard my pronouncements in the pulpit.
Muzorewa was the hero of the hour. But the two existing nationalist parties looked on with a jaundiced eye. Their rival was usurping the leadership role they claimed for themselves.
He's very wishy-washy. He hasn't the character to carry any nation on his back. No. No, no, no. He is easily flattered by those in power. This is his weakness. He's a good man, nice to talk to. But for the leadership of this nation, no, thank you.
Over the next few years, white complacency was ruffled by winds of change from east and south. In 1974, the Portuguese were driven out of their colony of Mozambique, and as a result, the whole 1,000-kilometer eastern border of Rhodesia became open to guerrilla activity. But that wasn't all. The South Africans realized they could no longer rely on white buffer states to protect them. And Prime Minister Forster chose to open a dialogue with black opponents further north, at which point Rhodesia became dispensable. Black politicians visiting Forster spotted the change immediately.
I got the impression that he was tired of supporting a lost cause, because having seen the Mozambicans, Mozambique and Angola go, I think they had a completely different perspective about Rhodesia.
Zambia now made Forster an offer. If he wanted to improve relations with black Africa by solving the Rhodesia problem, he'd have to get the nationalist leaders out of detention, withdraw his own troops, and hold all-party talks.
He said, you want me to ditch Ian Smith?
And did you say yes?
That was a rhetorical question. It was a statement, and I just tried to smile and look wise.
When he next visited Forster, Smith was puzzled by the line he took on their old opponents.
He said, I have had an undertaking from Kaunda and Ureri that if we can help them solve the Rhodesian problem, they will forever be grateful, and they will, in response, cooperate with us in trying to help us in what we're doing in South Africa.
Do you think he was right?
Well, of course he wasn't right, and I questioned him on that. I said, what do you mean, help you with your philosophy of apartheid? Oh, yes, he said. But I said, you don't believe that, do you? He said, I wanted to tell you, I've got them eating out of my hand. And he held his hand out in front of him. That's what Kaunda and Nyerere were doing.
I'm not afraid of that. And but we're not eating this from his hand.
The leaders of the two white powers in Southern Africa seem publicly to be close partners. In private, their relationship was breaking down.
He said to me, my dear friend, you've been so out of touch with the world around you for so long, you don't know what's going on these days. And I said, perhaps I shouldn't have, because I think it was provocative. I said, you know, under your philosophy of apartheid, you've been so far away from black people and their thinking for so long, I don't think you understand what goes on in the minds of black people, even in your own country. He didn't like that. I could see it.
Smith thought he knew better. The black leaders had been locked away for 10 years, and he assumed they were no longer a danger. When Forster asked him to set them free for talks in Zambia, he agreed. But he couldn't resist going to the airport to crow over them.
He first came and attacked Joshua Nkomo left, right and center. I was quiet. Joshua blew up, and I tried to intervene to calm Joshua. He left Joshua, he came and attacked me. It was worse. I got mad. And he was very rough with us. Up to now, I don't know what he wanted to achieve. But what I suspect is that he wanted to know whether the detention had cowed us down. But I'm sure, on the contrary, he discovered the opposite.
Do you regret that you let them out?
I don't think I regretted letting them out, because at the time it looked as though things were going to happen.
The joyful reunion in Zambia reignited the nationalist cause. But the message from the presidents of Zambia and Tanzania was uncompromising. If the nationalists wanted to keep their bases in those countries, they had to stop fighting each other and unite under one leader. And who better than the leader they'd chosen once before?
You of ZANU, chose Muzorewa. You of ZAPU chose Muzorewa. It's your own choice. So we are sitting here, we just want to formalize it. And what's there to debate? And that was true. That was it. So we couldn't squeeze out of that at all, although we didn't like it. But we couldn't very effectively argue against that.
Muzorewa was picked on and accepted by both ZANU and ZAPU because he was really a non-entity. Nobody saw him as a threat to their leadership.
No sooner were they back with their own supporters than the feuding started all over again. They treated the unity accord they'd signed with contempt.
We didn't feel that unity would be promotive of the armed struggle. We felt it was in fact meant to kill it.
But you accepted it?
Yes, we accepted it. We pretended to accept it. At heart, we didn't. And we said we must play it cleverly.
We already made up our minds that it wouldn't work. We would seem to be going along with the suggestion of the frontline states, but yet we knew that we would never unite with people like Muzorewa.
So you didn't mean a word of it?
Not a word. Not a word.
I don't know of anybody in the leadership of ZANU who meant it. I'd be surprised.
Forster now moved on to the second part of his bargain with the black states. It was August 1975. Without telling the Rhodesians, he pulled out his police patrols on Rhodesia's frontier with Zambia. Just before daybreak, Smith's telephone rang.
It was the Secretary of the Cabinet. He said, I've just had a message from the Army Chief to say that the South Africans are pulling out. No, I said, I don't believe that, because Forster told me that he wouldn't ever do anything without first consulting with me and putting me in the picture. So I said, you better check again. No, he said, I want to tell you that the vanguard is already at Bight Bridge. They've been travelling through from early in the evening. He said, clearly the intention was to do this in the dark in the hope that we wouldn't hear about it.
It was vital for Zambia to have these security forces from South Africa out. And that would achieve what we needed very badly, stretching Ian Smith's forces to the very limit.
It had one hell of an effect. It's like suddenly, you know, stretching your elastic a little bit further.
It didn't stop there. The South African munitions on which the Rhodesian forces depended no longer arrived on time. Forster was tightening the screw.
My son was a major in command of a troop of 25 pounders on the hills above Umtali. And I do know at around about that time they got down to about 5 rounds per gun. And they had instructions that they couldn't even fire one round, even if they had a target in front of them, without getting approval from Salisbury.
We were literally about to say that we couldn't conduct the war because we had not got enough ammunition to do it.
The excuse given to us from South Africa was that there was congestion on the railways. The line up through from Pretoria up to Bight Bridge and up into our country had got congested, or there'd been breakdowns or something, and suddenly stuff didn't arrive as readily and reliably as before.
Smith was being softened up for an unwelcome message. Forster summoned him to Pretoria and insisted he join all-party talks. To rub it in, Forster had Mark Chonner there, listening to every word.
He was showing no restraint in the presence of an African from a country that really is at war with Ian Smith. So it was clear that he was really sending to me a message that Ian Smith is expendable, and that I'm telling Ian Smith basically to move.
It was decided to hold the talks in this railway carriage, built in 1946 for the Governor General of South Africa. Mr. Forster had it sent from Johannesburg over 1,000 miles north to the border between Rhodesia and Zambia. This coach, which used to be the Governor General's dining room, was placed in the middle of the train, and it was parked at the exact center of the bridge that crosses the Zambezi River by the Victoria Falls. Ian Smith's delegation at one end of the table would be sitting in Rhodesia, and the Nationalists at the other end in Zambia. The unlikely sight of Forster and Kaunda leading the delegations onto the bridge for peace talks raised hopes of a fresh start between black and white in Africa. The different nationalist factions arrived, still under the nominal chairmanship of Bishop Muzorewa, and Smith and his team, reluctant participants, brought up the rear.
Well, we went, I thought to myself, you know, it's really a bit of a cooked up arrangement, a Heath Robinson affair. And when we got there and we saw what had been laid on either side of the conference room, they had two of their railway truck bars, refreshment places, on both sides, with every kind of drink in the world there, the things that we hadn't seen for a long time.
It's an impossible thing to hold a conference in a train anywhere, to have a whole gang of politicians and terrorists jammed in, but either side of a narrow table, to the extent that if you wanted to go to the other end, you actually had to go out onto the bridge and walk round to the other entrance to the carriage. And it was rather ridiculous.
White Rhodesians and black nationalists had never been this close before. Politically, they were still worlds apart in their vision of the future.
So we sat there facing each other, not like wild bulls, but angry faces, all right?
I let them go, thinking perhaps, as so often happens with these chaps, if you let them get the steam out of their system, they then cool down. But there was no cooling down there because there were half a dozen of them and they were all trying to outdo one another, you see.
I think, frankly, Ian Smith was too arrogant, too insulting, and too... too much in a hurry to show Foster that he was wasting his time.
Smith insisted that any further talks must be held in Salisbury. But he refused to give all the nationalists immunity from arrest.
The nationalists came and said, no, it will have to be an immunity for all the nationalists. Not those whom you think you can negotiate with, but all of us.
Kaunda and Forster soon realized that their initiative had failed. Smith told the nationalists that as far as he was concerned, the talks had no future.
Yeah, they were quite happy. They said, let's call it off. So we quietly went out and went back. They didn't quietly go out. They went back into the refreshment place there and they tell me that before they left, there wasn't a drop of alcohol left in the whole place. They'd cleaned it out and they staggered out.
The side that the nationalists had been on, I mean, looked like an occupied country, apparently, with every single thing either broken and certainly eaten, and every drop of liquor, which were considerable, was drunk.
Oh, well, I wouldn't deny that at all. We used it, but we are not drunk.
The Liberation War now entered a new phase. Smith's security forces were struggling against guerrilla incursions across the border from Mozambique. In the previous 2 years, they'd killed more than 500 guerrillas for the loss of 63 of their own men. But during 1975, the casualty rate on both sides accelerated. Smith knew he'd got a struggle on his hands, but in public he showed no sign of wavering.
I don't believe in black majority rule ever in Rhodesia, not in a thousand years. I repeat, I believe in black and whites working together. If one day it's white and the next day it is black, I believe we will have failed and I think it will be a disaster for Rhodesia.
A new player now entered the drama. Henry Kissinger knew little about Africa, but his intervention was decisive. He used America's might to change the course of events and force Smith to back down.
I thought that if we did nothing, either civil war in Rhodesia or raids by Rhodesia into Mozambique would lead to a call for Cuban armies, and that had to be prevented.
Kissinger believed a settlement in Rhodesia would reduce communist influence. For that, he needed South Africa's help, and he'd worked out how to appeal to them.
Henry Kissinger said to me, look, Ambassador, I want to make it clear to you that I understand your position. You are Africans. You've been there 300 years. You are a permanent part of Africa. But with all respect, he said, the Rhodesians have just come there the other day.
It is true. I thought the whites in Rhodesia were, in a way, vestiges of the imperial period. The whites in South Africa were, in a funny way, an African tribe.
Forster was flattered by Kissinger's attention. He flew to Europe to meet him. He was encouraged to find the United States sharing his fear of the spread of communism and keen to hear their remedy.
We first met as a group. Then I took Forster into a separate room. And I said, I want you to understand exactly what I'm after. I want to achieve majority rule for Rhodesia and commitment to majority rule for Namibia this year. And I would appreciate your cooperation for this. For the South Africans, the only real gain in this whole affair was gaining the goodwill of the United States by being responsible, cooperative, and a country one could deal with.
Smith must have guessed what was up, but he had no plan for dealing with it. In September 1976, he led the annual commemoration of Cecil Rhodes and the white pioneers who had founded Rhodesia. Shortly after, he was due in Johannesburg to watch the All Blacks play South Africa. Forster and Kissinger hoped it would put him in a receptive mood.
Ian Smith was a hero amongst most of the whites of this country. And I remember a day at one of our major rugby grounds where he was announced that Ian Smith was there. And the whole crowd of 60, 70,000 stood up and cheered him. That day he could win an election in South Africa.
Forster did not join in the adulation.
Forster wouldn't even sit next to me. Normally I used to sit next to him with the president of the association and so on. On this occasion, I was shunted off to one side. And the president of the association came and apologized to me and said he just had nothing to do with him. He wanted to make it clear.
Kissinger arrived with the authority of the American president behind him. He'd already squared his plan with Black Africa. Majority rule for Rhodesia within 2 years, in return trade sanctions would be lifted and the war would end. Now he had to confront Smith.
I think the mistake the British made was that they always talked to him first and I talked to him last.
I went hoping. I've no regrets about Kissinger. Kissinger was absolutely straightforward and honest with us. He said to us, I don't know anything about this case. He said, I've just been brought in.
He turned round to Ian Smith at one period of time and he said, Mr. Prime Minister, this is the first time in my career that I've had to ask anyone to commit political suicide.
I called him Mr. Prime Minister, which was against every rule, because he wasn't recognized. And I thought it couldn't do much damage to do that, since the whole purpose of the exercise was to deprive him of the position of Prime Minister.
Kissinger warned Smith that this was the best offer he could expect. After the American presidential election in November, it could only get worse. Both men moved into Forster's office. Smith was tense. He'd still not worked out what to do. And he was worried by someone who was constantly whispering in Forster's ear.
I said, who's this chap with the Colgate smile there? I've never seen him before. He seems to be having a big part to play. Oh, Hawkins said, that's Big Border. He's their representative at the United Nations. In fact, he said to me, this is his scheme, his brainwave, this whole thing.
Now, of course, it's a compliment to hear that I was really running the show. And I will certainly thank Mr. Ian Smith for that. The fact of the matter was, Mr. Forster was the Prime Minister and fully in charge, and I could only persuade him if my arguments made sense to him.
Forster didn't spell out the steps South Africa would take if Smith rejected the plan. He didn't need to. With Kissinger watching, he simply told Smith, if you don't stick to it, I'll drop you.
That Kissinger found himself in the role of a person who understood Smith's position, namely, you'll have to give up power. It is the end of your rule. You will have to accept what you said would never, ever happen. You will have to explain it to your voters. But I, Kissinger, want you to know that in saying to you that you had no alternative, I feel for you. And I think Inspet will accept that, that Kissinger had that warm, human feeling. I can almost call it a casual, a gentleman-like appreciation of Smith's dilemma and his anguish, if not his agony.
David Smith turned round to me and he said, Jack, he said, look at Henry Kissinger. He's crying. And Henry Kissinger is wiping tears out of his eyes. Now, when we mentioned this to Lord Burke, he poo-pooed it and he says, ach, that's just showmanship. But when we looked at Kissinger, he was shedding a few tears. What it was, I do not know.
You know, it may be a necessary job, but it's not an elevating job to deprive people of what, after all, two generations of Rhodesians, white Rhodesians, had accomplished there. Humanly, it was not a day of elation for everybody. I mean, I had achieved what I wanted to achieve, but it was sort of a strategic victory.
I could ignore Britain and America, as we had done for how many years. They were of no consequence to us. I could defy them. The one country I could not defy was South Africa.
Tears weren't in Forster's repertoire, but then he was a novice on the diplomatic stage.
When Kissinger's meeting was over, John Forster called us into a little room and he said, gentlemen, I have good news for you. I've just had a message and I can tell you that the goods are now moving, the trains are moving again, and all your stuff is on the way. The snags and the backlog has been overcome.
How did you react to that?
Well, we were disgusted. We knew what it was.
In public, Forster tried to cover up what he'd done.
Rhodesia wasn't pressurized in any way by South Africa at that time or at any time before that. I've always adopted the attitude that I was not prepared to twist Mr. Smith's arm, but that any decision he arrived at would be his own.
You couldn't get Ian Smith to see the argument. You had to use a bit of practical pressure.
Yes.
To get him to back down.
Yes. The answer is yes. It was clear to me that normal diplomatic decor is just not working. The medicine is having no effect.
In his mind, he was just trying, as he would put it, to maintain civilized standards in Africa.
Yes, civilized standards, you know. There can never be a fundamental civilization if the majority of a people in a country don't have the vote, let's face it. That is a fundamental human right and issue. And this most fundamental one he rejected.
Kissinger's plan was kept secret while Smith consulted his colleagues back home. But the bruising he'd received was plain to see.
I can remember flying back from Pretoria and the body language of our Prime Minister I shall never forget. I think he'd had an awful lot of pressure put on him.
What was his body language?
He looked like a chap who'd been 15 rounds. In the ring.
Smith now had to break the news to the people he'd so confidently led into rebellion 11 years before. Once it had been no black rule in 1,000 years. Kissinger's timetable was shorter.
Number one, Rhodesia agrees to majority rule within 2 years. Two,
the words were out. There was no going back.
I would be dishonest if I did not state quite clearly that the proposals which were put to us in Pretoria do not represent what, in our view, would be the best solution for Rhodesia's problems. Regrettably, however, we were not able to make our views prevail.
Although the broadcast ended with an empty flourish, Smith on the brink of defeat, quoting his hero Winston Churchill on his way to victory.
Now is not the end. It is not even the beginning of the end, but it is perhaps the end of the beginning. Good night, and may God be with you all during these trying times.
I was sad, sure. But I tried to contain that and keep it to myself, because obviously if my Rhodesian people thought I was upset and emotional, then I think it would have had an unfair effect on them. I couldn't tell them, it looks to me as though this is the end of the line and there's no hope. We had to try to hold the position.
The end of the line was still a long way off, and there'd be many thousands of deaths before it was reached. But Smith believed his fate had been decided by duplicity.
We were betrayed even by our own friends, and I think the history records this clearly.
Who are the greatest betrayers?
The South Africans, regrettably.
That is typical of Ian Smith. I'm sorry to say it is typical of his lack of understanding or his lack of capacity to summarize the facts as they exist. South Africa, what did South Africa owe Rhodesia after he got so much out of us against my personal wish? After he spent my taxpayers' money at the rate of hundreds of millions to come and say that we betrayed him? No, he betrayed us.
And the final program. Call us rebels, and you can call us rogues. We were founded by an Englishman by the name of Cecil Rhodes. We fought for this dear land of ours and many men to die. We may have to fight again, for this is UDI.
In 1976, Rhodesia's white rebellion against Britain entered its most deadly phase. The crack Salu scouts were trained in subterfuge to disrupt the liberation struggle against Ian Smith and his minority regime. Many black volunteers joined them, operating undercover. Bounty was paid for a successful mission.
If you killed one rebel, it was $50 on top of your salary. If there were two, you're talking about $100. And therefore, money-wise, it was very beautiful. They paid handsomely.
The rebel armies were youngsters who'd fled Rhodesia for training in neighboring countries like Mozambique and Zambia. They were now ordered home to fight in their own country.
I said, you are getting used to being comfortable on foreign soil. So off you go. You do it back home on Zimbabwean soil, across the border. No more. On foreign soil.
Ian Smith was in Switzerland for talks. Under pressure from South Africa and America, he just told Rhodesians that black majority rule would have to come, but not for 2 years and only with safeguards for the whites. The Patriotic Front, led by Robert Mugabe and Joshua Nkomo, thought they could still win by force.
The negotiations weren't serious. We were just insulting each other in the meetings. And, the Rhodesians were very arrogant. And we knew that we hadn't worked on them sufficiently yet.
Back home, white Rhodesia now put its trust in a new supreme commander, General Peter Walls. Walls was to become the dominant figure in the rebellion's final years.
We are going to fight. Our enemies had better understand this. We are no wishy-washy colonialists with no stake here.
It looked like a fight to the finish. Just across the Rhodesian border in Mozambique, you can still find evidence of the ferocity with which Rhodesia pursued the war. On a bend in the Niedzonia River, now overgrown with trees and thorn, are what look like crumbling concrete bunkers. This was one of Robert Mugabe's camps. The Rhodesians claimed it was being used to train his Zanla guerrillas. The nationalists said it housed refugees from Smith's Rhodesia. These are the mass graves of hundreds of men, women and children killed by the Rhodesian army in one morning. Their camp had first been identified by a Rhodesian reconnaissance flight.
On his way home, he saw a gap in the clouds. They came through it, and right below him, fortuitously, was the camp, which the navigator snapped quickly. They blew it up so they could actually count the heads, and there were 800 terrorist gooks, as we call them, formed up in a hollow square being addressed by their commander on the parade ground.
Over the next few weeks, the camp was kept under surveillance as its population grew to an estimated 5,000. In August 1976, Reed Daly decided it was time to strike. 70 Sulu scouts would cross the Mozambique border and drive into the Niedzonia camp disguised as guerrillas. They'd kidnap the commanders and destroy the camp. Reed Daly asked General Walls for his approval.
We unrolled all the maps on his floor, and he whistled in his teeth, and he looked at me and he said, "A hell of a risk, yeah?" And I said, "Oh, it'll work, because that's the last thing I expect."
At 8 in the morning, the force swirled into the camp. Their disguise was so effective that they were mobbed by a cheering crowd, but someone spotted that masked troops in the back of one truck were white.
So the column commander gave the word to fire. It was like a scythe going through a cornfield. They just went down like flies.
A lot of them were laid there, injured and screaming, okay. I remember one girl, she was also injured and she was crying. She came from my home area and it touched me, and after that I didn't want to think about it.
Our casualties were 4 lightly wounded, and they were over 1,000. The exact was 1,026.
Killed?
Killed. Now, in war, you can always, you work on, if for one killed, there's always at least 2 wounded. So there were a couple of thousand others who should have been running around with what we call oil leaks, you know.
I have never forgotten the kind of sight I saw there. I think they must have emptied some tons of ammunition, judging by the shells that gathered that almost half an acre or more of a camp, empty shells. It was really a massacre.
It was a good hit, and it certainly put Zanla back a long, long way.
It was played up as the usual way of being a refugee camp by the people on that side and by the United Nations. But I do believe that it was a justifiable military target.
Hickman's view is accepted by one of Mugabe's top commanders.
So you don't have a complaint about the principle of Niedzonia being attacked?
No.
As a soldier. They're talking to me as a soldier. Ah, yes. All I can say, like I was saying to General Rose, I said, how did you manage to knock us so flat? It really knocked us way to hurts militarily.
Niedzonia was followed by ferocious assaults on other guerrilla bases. They tested the resilience of Mugabe's forces to the limit.
You get so aggrieved, and it works on you and works on your emotion in such a way that you can never forgive perpetrators or action of this nature.
Mugabe reacted. He said, I'm beginning to wonder whether this armed struggle is worth pursuing. That's what he said to my face. When I expected such things to make someone more resolute, I felt very bad.
Don't pull the trigger yet until Larry tells you. Hold it nicely. Come on, look over there. Okay, you ready? Pull.
In Rhodesia, the whites were under increasing pressure. They no longer felt safe on their home ground.
Do not go in front of a gun. This thing is dangerous. Have you seen the effect of what this thing can do?
Guerrilla attacks on remote farms had become frequent. Families were taught self-defense. Men were called up for months at a time. What whites had claimed was the most peaceful country in Africa had become a war zone. Roads were impassable, except in armed convoy, because of the risk of mines. Africans were removed from their homes into protected villages to prevent contact with the guerrillas. But the army was worried it wasn't winning friends among the blacks. Successful military action needed a clear political framework.
We were weak, woefully weak, on the psychological side. And the other side were so very powerful psychologically. The Prime Minister said he knew what he was doing. So I'm not saying he didn't have a strategy in his head, but we couldn't get from the Deputy Prime Minister in his office, couldn't produce one to us. He couldn't.
In September 1978, the black nationalists scored a dramatic hit which shook Rhodesia. They downed a passenger aircraft on a flight from the holiday resort of Kariba.
Suddenly this terrific explosion, and we had instant fire on the starboard engine. Big fire, flames coming right back past even the last windows. And there's panic on the plane. People were screaming and jumping up.
When the plane hit the ground, many of the 56 passengers and crew died instantly. Anthony Hill and 17 others survived. Some escaped to a nearby village, but the most seriously injured could only crawl into a gully and wait for rescue. A group of guerrillas reached them first.
And I just heard a terrific burst of firing as they opened up on all the other survivors that I'd left in the gully. And I thought, you know, those poor people, that's them gone, because there was a long burst of firing and then short little bursts afterwards as they obviously finished off anybody who might still be moving. And there's people in the gully. There was one old couple and six women and three little children, and most of them badly injured. They couldn't move at all.
Whole families had been wiped out. Joshua Nkomo claimed his ZAPU forces had used a Russian-made missile to bring the plane down. The attack outraged the whites.
You know, in the war, a lot of things that are unacceptable happen. That's what I can say.
What effect did it have on ZAPU?
It had a very bad effect. We didn't like it. We spoke out about it amongst ourselves. That was one black mark against our military policy and system.
The Sarkatar, the Supreme Leader. We are attacking the terrorist base at Westland's Farm at this time.
Rhodesia's vengeance was swift. With a brusque warning to the Zambians to keep clear, they raided Nkomo's bases near the capital, Lusaka.
Rhodesia has no quarrel with Zambia or her security forces. We therefore ask you not to intervene or oppose our attack. Did you copy all that?
Copied.
Roger. Now, bombs gone and running. Beautiful.
Nkomo's military commander was caught up in the attack.
The bombs are good.
When I looked up, I said, there they are. And I couldn't believe it. I failed even to run.
They're like ants running around there, huh?
Dibengwa took cover under a tree.
I don't know how I escaped, because that tree had all its branches cut almost up to about 6 inches above me. And I came out not with a scratch. I mean, I had to feel my legs and find out whether they were still there when I got up.
With attacks from the air and by land, the Rhodesian army killed 1,600 of Nkomo's fighters in one day. They showed film of their achievement to bolster morale among their own troops.
Most of the terrorists wore some kind of uniform. Some were caught washing in the river.
Never before had I seen so many dead bodies. And I would think, maybe they're playing games. Maybe if somebody blew a whistle, they would wake up. There were so many, you couldn't believe it. And those injured, some with their tummies open and still screaming for help, which you could not give.
The air crews who'd carried out the raid became heroes. Their message to the Zambian control tower used in a hit single.
The Shaka Tower, the screen leader. I'm going to Rock Tower, the screen leader. This is a message for the station commander at Mwamba.
This is what God would have willed. Kill or see the children killed.
Despite some military successes, Smith was under pressure politically, not least from South Africa. In 1978, he struck a surprising deal with black moderates. He stood down, allowed everyone the vote, and made way for Rhodesia's first black prime minister. Bishop Abel Muzorewa swept into office, but white political power was still protected, and the guerrillas boycotted the elections. Only black moderates had faith in Muzorewa's triumph.
The thing that Mr. Ian Smith had at last conceded to one person, one vote, we felt victorious. If we had been out in the countryside, we would have killed a cow and bring a lot of people to celebrate. Yeah, it was a very moving day.
Rhodesia now needed international acceptance. They were putting their faith in the new conservative government, which took office in Britain a few weeks later. They thought that having a black prime minister would be enough to persuade Margaret Thatcher to recognize their independence.
Where there is discord, may we bring harmony.
Her foreign secretary, Lord Carrington, had other ideas. He didn't think that recognizing Muzorewa would end the war, and he asked his officials to come up with a different plan.
We, the British, should actually take over the country, recolonize Rhodesia, establish a constitution which we could defend against all comers, and then decolonize it. Now, this plan, perhaps by nature of its boldness and its slightly it's obviously risky characteristics, appealed to Margaret Thatcher.
I also think, perhaps it sounds rather priggish, I also think you had an obligation to try and settle it. After all, it was our responsibility.
3 months later, a nervous Mrs. Thatcher arrived in Zambia for her first Commonwealth conference. She feared a hostile reception from those who thought she was going to recognize Muzorewa. But what she said transformed the atmosphere.
The aim is to bring Rhodesia to legal independence on a basis which the Commonwealth and the international community as a whole will find acceptable. The British government is wholly committed to genuine black majority rule in Rhodesia.
Britain now planned to summon a Rhodesia conference in London. Despite her initial skepticism, Thatcher had stuck to the line worked out by Carrington, and on the flight home, she acknowledged its success.
We picked up our briefcases and went forward, and as we went through the curtain, there we saw a beaming prime minister, and alongside her was a stewardess with a tray full of glasses of champagne. And she said, to the Foreign Office.
Lancaster House, just along the Mall from Buckingham Palace, was the setting for the next act in the drama, a conference to which all the main players were invited. Carrington was determined that it would see the resolution of the Rhodesian crisis.
Everybody wanted it. Of course, they all thought that their particular side would win. The one person who didn't want it was Mugabe.
I didn't believe that Lancaster was going to yield anything, to tell you the truth. And of course, we didn't want Lancaster anyway. We wanted to continue with our fighting.
This initiative was quite unlike anything Britain had tried before. Once the delegates had been flattered by their welcome in the grandeur of Lancaster House, the going got tough. Britain had already decided on the terms of a settlement, drawn up an agenda which allowed no deviation, and set a timetable.
I was berated by Mugabe because he thought that I was an appalling sort of schoolmaster who was telling everybody what to do. And I think that Joshua thought I was some sort of spider who was weaving terrible webs around everybody.
I say to him, you're sitting in the center of your network, and we've been pushed into various parts of your network, and you swallow us one by one. He wasn't happy about that one, but I felt he was behaving like a spider.
Carrington knew that the key to success was to keep the patriotic front in the talks. But he told them that if they walked out, he'd do a deal with Muzorewa. The threat worked.
Carrington wanted us to decide on our own that no, we had had enough, we won't agree with this and we'll quit. But no, we knew that strategy.
More pressure came from the presidents of Mozambique, Zambia and Tanzania. They told the Patriotic Front, settle or we'll close down your bases.
We compromised under tremendous pressure from our allies as well as from the British government.
Yeah, you'll be told. You know, after all, you're making use of our countries and our people are dying and so forth. You are not being reasonable. Come on.
The delegate awaited with the greatest trepidation in London was General Tongagara, Mugabe's senior guerrilla commander.
Smith is our great teacher because all the attacks he has made on us has improved our tactics.
He was quite a revelation when he came to London. Tall, strapping man with a lively sense of humour, big personality. And on the very opening day of the negotiations, we adjourned to coffee into one of the grand gilded rooms of Lancaster House, and each delegation stood in its own corner and eyed each other very suspiciously. And you know, it was Tongagara who broke the ice. He put down his cup and saucer, strode across to the White Rhodesians and walked up to Ian Smith and said, you won't remember me, but I was a small boy playing on your farm while my mother was a labourer.
I looked at him and I said, who are you? He said, Tongagara. To say Tongagara. He did say that he'd never forgotten how kind my mother had been to him, because evidently she used to give them sweets and odd things like that.
Tongagara's apparent willingness to let bygones be bygones was an encouraging sign. His arch-enemy, General Walls, was taken aback.
Tongagara, to my complete surprise, stood up and he said, stop all this bloody talking. Peter Walls and I will sort it out. Leave it to us. We'll do it. Mugabe looked as if he'd got a stomachache, and Nkoma sort of looked as if, well, yeah, is this your chap talking out of turn? I just didn't say anything.
He was one of the most impressive black men I have ever met, a decent black, who spoke reconciliation when the rest were still saying, we want revenge.
As the weeks passed, Carrington's agenda began to take shape. First, a new constitution was agreed. Then discussions turned to a ceasefire and the elections to follow. The plan was for Britain to take direct control of Rhodesia while the settlement was implemented. This meant persuading the newly elected Prime Minister to stand down.
The foolish Muzorewa, having been warned that he was going to be jettisoned, led up the garden path and dumped. unfortunately had no effect on the fall.
Carrington had said to him, you know, we just want you to pull out of the Prime Minister's office just to help in what we are doing. We know you're going to go back. In fact, you can leave your slippers in the Prime Minister's house. Those were Carrington's words to poor old Muzarewa.
Was it a difficult decision?
It was a difficult decision, and a lot of people, including my members of cabinet, didn't like that.
It wasn't nearly as difficult as it ought to have been from his point of view.
It wasn't as difficult as it ought to have been.
Well, from his point of view, if he would have said no.
Rhodesia's leader through the years of rebellion was now isolated, the only member of his delegation to oppose Carrington's plan. He decided to go home, but not before giving Carrington a piece of his mind.
I said to him, but this is going to ensure that we are going to end up with a Mugabe government, a Zanu-PF government. I told Carrington. Oh, my dear friend, he said, you've got the thing completely wrong. The whole plan is that the next government in Rhodesia is going to be a government of Nkomo, Muzarewa and Smith.
Did you say that to him?
No, of course not. I'll tell you about Ian Smith. I never really got on terribly well with Ian Smith. That when I was in the middle of this conference, he suddenly said to me, the trouble with you, he says, is you're letting this go dragging on. And while you're doing that, people are being killed in Rhodesia. And it was the only time I really lost my temper. And I said to him, Mr. Smith, but for you, nobody would be killed in Rhodesia. And that was the end of that.
For the British, the most important white Rhodesian at Lancaster House was a soldier, not a politician. General Walls was the key to securing a ceasefire. His detractors thought the Foreign Office was leading him by the nose.
I took him out to lunch, dinner, everything you can think of, and furthermore, I established a real friendship with Walls, who I really liked.
The Foreign Office I couldn't stand. I really didn't like them. I thought that they were really... I don't think they did anything to make us feel warm.
Again, Carrington and the Foreign Office, they're clever people. They arranged for the Queen Mother to invite him and his wife to have tea with her one morning.
Wall says crossing the road to Clarence House wasn't a British idea. The initiative came from him.
They said to me, is there any place you'd like to go? We were invited to Carrington's for a weekend. I did not go. I was asked if I'd like an audience with the Queen, and I said, no, thank you. But I said, there is one thing I would like to ask. When the royal family came to southern Rhodesia, as it was, in 1947, King George and Queen Elizabeth spent a lot of time talking to my father. I said, I would like to pay my respects just for a few minutes to the Queen Mother.
I don't think she knew what they were up to. So they went and had tea with him. And the British said that from that moment on, they had no problem with Walls.
It had nothing to do with Lancaster House. It had nothing to do with the negotiations. We never talked about the negotiations at all. My wife and I went to a kind of high tea. We sat and talked about her visit to southern Rhodesia. She talked about all sorts of things. At one stage she said, listen to that. She pointed up and she said, that's those corgis. They're so naughty. They think they should be in here.
I think to be invited to tea there affected him greatly.
So you were up to your old Foreign Office tricks all the time, really?
We were up to our old Foreign Office tricks, but that's how negotiations succeed.
The British wanted to persuade Walls that his troops should pull back to their barracks and guarantee the guerrillas safe conduct to 15 assembly areas. Walls was worried. Once both sides had disengaged, Mugabe's people would have a free rein. Then they could terrorize and intimidate voters in the election. He thought the British were so keen to get Rhodesia off their hands, they'd do nothing to stop it. It took a private meeting with Margaret Thatcher in Downing Street to convince him.
She said she didn't want a Marxist government. She regarded Mugabe as Marxist. She didn't want terrorists to get there by terrorism and intimidation. She said, if you think it necessary, you can appeal to me direct, and I'm giving you that right of access. So I said that if we thought it was worthwhile trusting anybody, perhaps we could trust her. She'd given her word.
With the talks in London dragging into their fourth month, Carrington decided to force the pace. Without waiting for the final agreement, he asked Christopher Soames, a cabinet colleague, to take over in Salisbury as British governor. After 14 years of rebellion, Britain was back in charge. The friendly welcome was short-lived.
As Lord and Lady Soames arrived at Government House, the talks in London were in crisis. Just as it seemed that everything was settled, the negotiators of the Patriotic Front demanded an extra assembly point for their guerrillas, and they wanted it not on the borders of Rhodesia, but right in the centre. The British knew that this would infuriate the Rhodesians, but they didn't want the talks to break down over the issue, and so they asked Soames to sort it out.
Soames treated the request as routine and left it to his staff to arrange. But Walls was adamant. He wouldn't accept a large guerrilla force gathering in the centre of the country.
At some stage or other, when they were getting fairly sort of worn down and desperate, and I was getting pretty damned angry, in burst Lord Soames. I don't like to speak ill of the dead, but he certainly had, you know, enjoyed his evening's refreshment, shall I say. And he came in all bluster and bonhomie and, you know, whoa, what's the problem, you know, rare, and all the rest of it. And I'd had a gutsful.
I must say, I didn't realize at the time quite what an important, how important this would be seen to be by General Walls and his people. And I said, hello, General, how are you? And look, we want one more assembly point. Where should we have it? Well, I ran slap into it, and this was something that they minded about like hell.
And I said, it's out of the question. You've already got us to agree to far more than we ever wanted to. We're certainly not going to contemplate something different now. And as far as I'm concerned, it's out, finished.
And I think that his words were to the effect that he'd already been pushed too far, and if he was pushed any further, he'd pull the rug out.
I stormed out of the room, went off down the driveway with Brigadier Adam Gurdon, I think it is, coming after me saying, please, General, and I used a word which I wouldn't like to be quoted as coming from me, but I was damn cross. And I said, he can footsack, with words to that effect.
Christopher was deeply disconcerted. But that was it. It absolutely ruptured the relationship between General Walls and Christopher.
The Patriotic Front won their assembly point, and Carrington won his settlement. 4 days before Christmas, the Lancaster House agreement was ready for signature.
Well done, do you understand that we keep this?
Yeah, of course you can.
I do?
Yeah. It's the least we can do.
Beautiful.
I didn't really ever believe, even till almost the end, that this was going to work. You were really sitting on the edge of a volcano.
The first part of the agreement to be implemented was the most dangerous, the ceasefire. Small groups of Commonwealth troops were dispatched to the assembly areas to await the arrival of the guerrillas. For the next 3 months, their job was to supervise them. Each group had one or two Patriotic Front liaison officers attached to it to smooth things along. At assembly area Papa, at Rukomichi in the Zambezi Valley, no one appeared for 2 days. The guerrillas feared a trap. On the third day, armed men started to emerge from the bush, slowly at first, and then in their hundreds. The liaison officer assigned to the monitoring force had gone out into the bush alone to persuade the guerrillas that it was safe to come in. Their commander had told him that if anything went wrong, he would be held personally responsible.
I said, if you are attacked, you are going to be the first person
to be attacked by us, because we are going to take off your neck first. We'll cut off your throat.
What did you make of that?
That didn't sound an empty threat to me. They were rather serious, because the situation was so volatile, and as it were, I gambled with my own life and said, gentlemen, if anything like that happens, you can do what you want with me, including shooting me.
In the tense atmosphere, any incident could threaten the ceasefire. At Papa, meat rations ran out. 200 armed men surrounded the British officer in charge and demanded access to the stores. He faced a mutiny with only 6 rifles and a light machine gun in the British armory.
I made it clear that if they wanted to take the food, then I was under orders to make sure that they didn't. I then effectively went back into the camp, and to my part of the camp, and radioed for help.
Were you alarmed at this point?
Yes, because basically, if I was seen to be weak or in any way give way to their demands, which then my credibility was at stake, and so frankly was the ceasefire.
A helicopter was dispatched from Salisbury with the British liaison officer, Andrew Parker Bowles, and 3 of Nkomo's senior commanders.
The helicopter pad was all surrounded with armed people, with guns aimed at us. It was a very ugly scene. And I had to be firm with them, and they said, no way, at least not the monitoring team. You couldn't harm those.
And then Bermati, who was a tough man, came forward, pulled out those men who had been involved in holding the British officer hostage, and took them off somewhere. And certainly a shot was fired. I don't know whether one was killed or not, but they were certainly then buried in almost tombs with bars on, where they stayed without water and food for at least 2 days, and then order returned to that particular assembly area.
At Government House, Lord Soames fretted, watching to see whether the ceasefire would hold. If it collapsed, his monitoring force could be trapped. He described the experience later as like walking on eggshells.
I've never seen Christopher so wrought up, so tense, and he couldn't sleep at night. I mean, you know, he just used to toss and turn. After we put the light out, we used to listen to lovely Impromptu by Schubert, and it used to soothe him.
The whole thing could have erupted. I mean, one tiny slip could have brought the whole thing crashing down.
One tiny slip is what elements in the Rhodesian army were hoping for. With their enemy now conveniently corralled in assembly sites, they were looking for a pretext to attack. General Walls called his commanders to a secret meeting to prepare the ground.
We were given orders to plan attacks on various targets, and in the case of the RLI, it was 2 of the assembly areas. One was at Rakomachi Mission in the Zambezi Valley, and one was at Marymount, up in the northern border.
We were given 2 assembly areas, not far away from where we were, one in Gwanda and one in the Triangle, Hotel and Juliet, to take out.
It was a simple, straightforward, combined air ground attack.
With the aim of doing what to the guerrillas?
Killing them.
In breach of the ceasefire, Aust reconnoitred the assembly areas Walls had allocated him. One was Papa at Rukomachi.
We knew we were being watched on all these mountains along the Zambezi escarpment by special forces from the Rhodesian army.
So it would have been a reasonably simple thing for the Rhodesian forces, had they wanted to use low-flying aircraft or helicopters to come over the escarpment at relatively short notice and take them out.
In retrospect, we know it was perhaps crazy. But at the time, with the feelings that pertained at that time, the fact that so many people had died and there'd been so much grief, a desperate measure was acceptable.
Orse Battalion was next sent, without British authority, to an airfield within firing range of another assembly area, Delta.
I was met by the brigadier who gave orders that the assembly area had been totally ill-disciplined. They were breaking the terms of the ceasefire, and it was a serious threat to peace in the area. And I was ordered to plan a combined ground-air assault on that assembly area.
He scanned the camp, but could see no signs of trouble. At that moment, a senior commander of the monitoring force happened to fly over the airfield on his way to Delta.
And lo and behold, to my amazement, on the ground, I saw three Dakota aircraft, what I estimated to be about six 105mm field guns, what I estimated to be about a battalion's worth of infantry soldiers, a fire team. Now, a fire team is really a couple of armed helicopters, the things we used to call in Vietnam gunships, and a couple of what appeared to be light armoured vehicles. I mean, it was a very, very strong force.
By the time Cole arrived at Delta, the assembly area was in turmoil. The guerrillas had spotted the Rhodesian force and were preparing a preemptive strike. Cole sent his colonel back to the airfield to read the riot act to the Rhodesian commander.
And out of the helicopter stepped a most irate Australian, I think he was a colonel, who immediately gave the brigadier a severe tongue lashing. And it actually was a little bit embarrassing. I didn't know where to look. And I can remember his opening words were, just what the hell do you think you're doing, Brigadier?
And it was so obvious that they were attempting to intimidate the Patriotic Front to leave the assembly. Because had they have done that, and had the Patriotic Front cleared the 500-metre no-go zone around the assembly place, then the Rhodesians could have made a very good case that they were merely handling a situation that got out of control.
Their plan frustrated, they returned to Salisbury with a display of strength, again unauthorised.
Just explain to me who you were meant to be reporting to, because some ways it seems if you weren't reporting to anybody.
My conscience. The governor, theoretically, is. When he didn't tell me to do what I knew needed doing, I did it anyway. And then he would have to condone that and make it look as if I'd acted on his instructions.
The British found Walls increasingly difficult to handle. They claimed that at times he seemed scarcely rational.
He was entirely due to exhaustion. Walls was dealing with every little problem that rose in Rhodesia. I mean, he even dealt with a problem once of a shortage of milk in Umtali.
At the end of January 1980, Robert Mugabe returned from exile. Welcomed back by his fellow Shona tribesmen, he had decided to split from Nkomo and go for all-out victory in the election. The British still banked on an anti-Mugabe coalition made up of Nkomo, Muzorewa and Ian Smith. In the rural areas, there were reports of widespread intimidation, particularly by Mugabe's supporters. Under the terms of Lancaster House, the governor had the power to disqualify the offenders or a whole party. Joshua Nkomo and the Foreign Office were pressing Soames to take action against Mugabe, but he refused. He thought a peaceful transition was best guaranteed by making sure the election race started with all the horses in the gate.
This is Africa. This isn't little Puddleton in the marsh. And they behave differently, and they think nothing of sticking tent poles up each other's whatnot, you know, and doing filthy, beastly things to each other. It does happen, I'm afraid.
With election day approaching, one of the governor's staff asked Mugabe how many of the 80 black seats he expected to win.
He said without any hesitation, 56. And I was quite taken aback by, A, the precision of this, and B, the large number. And I said, how can you be so sure about the number, and why is it so large? And I think he thought I was politically very naive. He said, because I've got cells in all those areas and I control them, so that's what I will win. Well, I shot back into the governor's office and said, do you know what Robert Mugabe's just told me? And I think it was at that point we suddenly realised that we were not going to be talking about coalitions anymore. Robert Mugabe would be forming a government, and that was the plan from there on.
Up to this point, relations between the governor and Mugabe had been frosty, but Soames now told Mugabe he accepted that he would be the first Prime Minister of Zimbabwe.
That was the breakthrough meeting, and they had a very cordial and clear understanding after that, that provided the level of intimidation was at a minimal level, then the election would go ahead, Mugabe would run in that election, and the governor would not ban him from the election.
The British kept the understanding secret. As polling began, they maintained the pretense that the governor might still ban Mugabe's party, though in reality, he'd ruled it out.
It was necessary for him to keep up the feeling that he would use that power if necessary. In a way, we were playing a confidence trick on the white military, the white population as a whole. We were playing it for, we believed, their own good. And but nevertheless, we were in fact representing to them that the level of intimidation was not such as to distort the electoral results.
The British did nothing to upset the widespread perception that a coalition excluding Mugabe was the likeliest outcome.
If there was a coalition government, maybe it could be Muzorewa and Nkomo, something of that sort. I think some of us believed that more than others. I myself did not believe it. But nevertheless, one had to go on representing to the whites that it was all to play for.
Ian Smith had already won all 20 parliamentary seats reserved for whites, but the black count hadn't yet begun. Rhodesian intelligence and the military were still predicting a victory for their favoured candidate, Muzorewa. Smith himself wasn't so sure. He asked Walls to his house and challenged him face to face.
What is your contingency plan for this assessment you've just given me, proving to be wrong, and Mugabe wins? So I had cornered Walls. He then had to answer. And he simply said, we will not allow it.
The Rhodesian army had tried to discredit Mugabe. During the campaign, the Selous scouts had bombed churches in Salisbury and blamed it on Mugabe's men. There'd also been attempts on his life. Now, as a last resort, Walls turned to Mrs. Thatcher. He asked her to carry out the promise he thought she'd made.
I sent a signal to Mrs. Thatcher. I urged her to cancel the election, let stability be restored and so on, and then to have another election which would be free and fair.
The reply from Number 10 was sent through official channels. Walls was simply informed that the Prime Minister saw no reason to intervene. It wasn't what he'd hoped for.
She said, you will have access to me like one of my generals, like the chief of the general staff, face to face, you to me, me to you. It didn't happen. So her word was worth nothing.
Walls now admits something he's always denied in the past. As the count got underway, he planned to arrest Mugabe's key lieutenants and himself declare the election null and void. If there was any trouble from Mugabe's troops, the army was ready to strike.
I wouldn't call it a coup.
What would you call it?
It was unconstitutional action, which is what I told Mrs. Thatcher in my signal to her, that I would loathe to have to take such action, but I reserved the right to do so. She knew that.
The governor would be presented with a fait accompli, a tactic Walls had used successfully before.
It was going to appear to be a concurrent thing that we did it, and he agreed and approved it.
You were going to annul the election, effectively,
yeah,
and then tell him that he'd better go along with it.
And say that he agreed, yeah. And it would have worked if it hadn't been compromised, I think. Because it had been a complete breach, which we only learnt about literally hours before it would have been put into action. People who were due to be picked up or arrested throughout the country moved from their positions. They were aware of what was going to happen in detail. I decided, rightly or wrongly, and it was a very hard decision to make, that it was no good going on with the thing which would not achieve its objective.
Walls hadn't realized that there were spies in his camp. Mugabe's head of intelligence says he was one step ahead of him.
I knew what they were doing. The Rhodesian commanders, when they were having meetings, they still drank tea. And they were used to have blacks serve them. And they continued to discuss what they were trying to do when the blacks were serving tea. And the blacks belonged to me.
Were they planted by you?
Recruited is the correct word. Recruited by me, not planted.
Wouldn't there have been bloodshed and indeed a return to war if you'd acted unilaterally to pick up people and...
If we'd acted unilaterally unsuccessfully, there would have been that. Return to bloodshed, war, the lot of it. That's why I couldn't go through with it.
Wall's subordinates were still waiting impatiently for the signal to move. But on the eve of the election result, Walls went on television with a different message.
Anybody who steps out of line, I say again, will be dealt with effectively and swiftly, whoever they are and whatever their motives.
Mugabe and his men had neutralized the threat from his white opponents.
We called the head of the Air Force, the head of the police, the head of the army, and the head of security, these four. We called them at night to meet the president, and then the president said, look, you can now see that we knew they were planning coup. You know, I'm winning these elections, and now I have no regular army. My army is a guerrilla army. So I would want you, General Walls, to become my commander of the new Zimbabwe army.
I went to his house and sat down and said, I can't possibly work for you because you're a Marxist. And he said, do you know, General, that the teachings of Karl Marx are identical to those of Jesus Christ? And I said, well, you can knock me over with a feather, but I can't argue with you.
So General stood up, put his hat on, and saluted and accepted.
Well, I asked him a number of questions. Why did you want to kill me? And he said, no, it wasn't him. He wouldn't have done that thing so naive. And I said, what does he mean? He said, well, it must be some of those special branch people.
You didn't want to see Mugabe dead.
I didn't want Mugabe to win the election, because of what he was.
Did you trust Walls?
No, I didn't. Not at all. I talked to him and gave him the impression I had faith in him. But I never trusted him. Not for one moment. We would watch him and see what he would do. But we would bide our time, and in due course we'd get rid of him. Which we did.
53,343 votes. When the election results were announced, Mugabe's victory was decisive. 57 Mugabe had won 57 of the 80 African seats, one more than he'd predicted. Nkomo, all 20 in his tribal area of Matabeleland, and Muzorewa, a miserable 3.
I think it stinks, and the British stink with it because you've just given a victory to bloody Russia, you idiot.
With no signal from Walls to act against Mugabe, the commanding officer of the Rhodesian Light Infantry felt he owed his men an explanation.
I formed the entire battalion up, and I said, it is a cock-up. Those are the exact words I used. There was no questions permitted. I apologized to the entire regiment, and we had a prayer, and we fell out.
The euphoria that greeted Mugabe's victory caused panic among the whites. Many were packing up to leave Rhodesia the same day. With Soames' encouragement, Mugabe pleaded with them to stay.
I urge you, whether you are black or white, to join me in a new pledge to forget our grim past. Forgive others and forget. Join hands in a new amity, and together as Zimbabweans, trample upon racialism, tribalism and regionalism.
The stage was set for the final act. Prince Charles arrived from London to preside over the ceremony. It would see the colony of Rhodesia make way for the independent state of Zimbabwe. Aside from his official engagements, the prince had an informal program. He was due to visit a farm where wild buffaloes were trained to pull ploughs. Disaster was averted by the young army officer sent to check the protocol for the visit, Andrew Parker Bowles.
They said they were going to ask Prince Charles, as a horseman, to ride one of these buffaloes. So I said, well, somebody else, I'd like to see somebody else ride it. There's no good putting a black boy on, I want to see a white man. So they turned on me and said, we're all the right size and height, on you get. So I got on, and it wasn't an easy ride. I was about to jump off when I was bucked off, and his other friend, who moved like the speed of lightning, the next moment I knew, he had gored me in the thigh, and I was right up in the air. And I was left lying in the dust with the horn right through onto my artery.
So if it hadn't been you injured, it had been Prince Charles?
Well, that's one way of looking at it, yes.
It was only 90 years since Cecil Rhodes had founded the colony. Now it was all over.
There were emotional moments at the end. The Union Jack was coming down for the last time, the bugle playing, the governor was standing to attention, tears running down his face.
And then it was folded up, and the guard commander handed it to Prince Charles, who turned to Christopher and said, I think this should be yours.
We were all taken to have a photograph in what was then Government House. There was the Prince of Wales and Mugabe and me. There we all are under Rhodes's picture. And I find that in a way rather ironic.
What emotion did you have?
Joy, overwhelmed that the day had finally come. And we're now ourselves.
And to be standing in front of a portrait of Cecil Rhodes?
Cecil Rhodes, I didn't even think about him.
As the moment of independence approached at midnight, the man who'd fought so hard to get his sort of independence stayed away.
I was happier not to be there. I thought they should be raising the Union Jack, not lowering the Union Jack. So the whole scene would have been a bit distasteful to me.
Well, you were the man who lowered the Union Jack in Rhodesia.
Well, we still had our loyalty to the Empire and the Queen, remember that.
For 14 years, whites in Rhodesia had defied Britain and the world to protect their privilege and power. Today, many of them point to the corruption and poverty of Mugabe's Zimbabwe and say, we told you so. But no one claimed black majority rule would guarantee prosperity or an end to oppression, just that majority rule itself had become inevitable, and to defy it was futile.
the war forced them politically to surrender and give up some of their dreams, like majority rule never in a thousand years. And we did it in the only effective way, and that was through the bullet. Who's that name?